seminar series is dedicated to Dr. John Flea, and I'm sure all of you know why, right? He's put a lot of years in developing programs here, so I personally have a lot of respect for him and admiration. So hopefully we will rise the seminar to the level of his work. Okay, so those of you that have not met me yet, my name is Pierre Church-Morley, and I'm an associate professor of physics engineering department. So I'm going to be talking about some work I've been doing in earthquake prediction using a set of techniques called tomography. Here's the seminar series, like I say again. We are trying to encourage collaboration and information sharing between departments and try to promote an atmosphere of research, undergraduate research. There is a whole lot of speakers we're anticipating to have. So I start up today. Tomorrow, Dr. Free starts, Dr. Salton Jenkins. And then we have an invited speaker. Then we have all the rest of it is students. So let me start by saying that we have a lot of, we see, as I look across, we have very good cross section of the community. We are glad to have one of our, could you stand up just for the rest of the people to see you? Yeah. All engineering professors came in to visit us here. And we have Charlie from IT. Everybody knows him. We have one of the people that have been a long time adjunct professor there, set up back there, junior. So, and Salton. So, we're glad to have everyone here. Okay, so, about a year and a half ago, we started working with Japan. And I want to use that as the platform to introduce this talk. So Professor Heki Kosuke, out of the Department of Natural Science, Department of Science of Hokkaido University, has been working with us, providing us a lot of support, data, information, and all that. And their dream is to see us, ENC, develop a three-dimensional, real-time earthquake monitoring program. Okay? And they're giving us the support. So let me introduce this with a clip from him, and that will give you a good idea what the problem is that we're trying to solve.
Even though GPS can measure the surface of the Earth in great detail, it cannot predict tectonic shifts beneath the ground. It can tell us what has happened, not what is about to happen. Or that's what we thought. Professor Kosuke Heki analyzes GPS signals, but he's not working out his location. He tries to work out why they fluctuate. He measures how much GPS is disrupted by electrons in the atmosphere. It's called the TEC, or total electron content. Professor Heki has been studying how, after big earthquakes, rumbling sound waves disrupt GPS signals. But in the days after the Tohoku earthquake, he noticed something unexpected. He discovered a strange disruption in the GPS signals before the earthquake happened. I want to understand what's happening with this phenomena. So can you show me a curve of what's happening with no earthquake and what's happening if an earthquake is coming?
Okay. So let's assume this is TEC.
That TEC, that's the number of electrons
that's right.
in the ionosphere, about
yes.
300 kilometers up.
Yes.
Okay.
And this is time.
Time.
And if there's no earthquake, it behaves like a smooth curve, like this.
Why do we get that strange curve? Why isn't it flat?
Because of the movement of the GPS satellite in the sky. So this is a kind of apparent movement. Apparent change.
So when it goes through a thick bit of atmosphere,
yeah,
you get more electrons.
That's right.
As it's straight overhead, mm-hmm, you get fewer electrons.
Yes.
And then again, you get a thick bit.
Yeah.
Okay, that makes sense. So you get a curve.
Yes.
But that's if no earthquake's going to happen.
Yeah. And if there's an earthquake here, for example.
So that's the earthquake.
Yeah, this is an earthquake. Then it will leave the normal curve about 1 hour before the earthquake, like this. And there's a disturbance caused by the sound wave.
So it suddenly seems from this curve, because it's higher than this one, you're getting more electrons in the atmosphere.
That's right.
That seems strange. You've got an earthquake coming, and suddenly you're getting more electrons in the atmosphere.
Yeah, that's a very strange phenomenon. So
it's thought that in the lead up to an earthquake, forces deep underground somehow energize electrons high in the atmosphere, which in turn disrupts GPS signals. And Heikki has noticed this has also happened before other earthquakes too, like Chile in 2010. It's a remarkable discovery, which at the moment scientists don't fully understand. But it offers hope that one day GPS will act as an earthquake predictor, saving countless lives.
Okey-doke. So that's the challenge for us there, is to get to that point where we can make that happen. Where routinely we can use GPS signals to reconstruct not just what they are measuring here, it's just what they call the TEC, we're going to talk about that a bit more, but we want to reconstruct the entire atmosphere in real time, okay? What the concentration is. So we want to continue developing this sort of relationship with Professor Heikki, and some point say something interesting. So we have two students actually working on this problem. Michael Bryan, where are you sitting? Yeah, and Joseph Armstrong. So they'll have something to tell you in their respective presentations upcoming. So let me tell you something about this problem. So here's an outline of the talk. I'll talk about some introduction, motivation, give you some history about, start to give you a feel of what the atmosphere is, some basic of wave propagations to how, why do we worry about the atmosphere, why does the atmosphere behave the way it does, a little bit of atmospheric physics, and then we start talking about how do we get observation from the atmosphere, from GPS, how do we sense it, how do we model it, talk a little bit about the complexity in the problem, why is it and quickly what's being done right now and a little bit of what we might do, and then we get into earthquake basics, how do you monitor and predict, what are the preliminary results we're getting, but way back when I started this and with the improvements that the students are making and where we go from there. Okay, tomography is the first thing I want to talk to you about. Here's a picture of a guy with his head cut off. Doesn't look very comfortable there. But so what that is illustrating is a cut, the edge cut through his head. And you can think of taking several of these, and if you were able to put them back together, either if you were taking horizontal or vertical cuts, you could come up with pictures like this. Taking these cuts in some way, and then going back and reconstructing them to put what the inside of the head looks like. So that's tomography, really. It's a slice representation plus graph. So you put all the slices together, and you end up with this 3D picture that reconstructs an object. And the idea is how do you come up with these slides, right? And how do you put them back together? But that's the primary of tomography. So before I'm done here, I'm going to show you that we can use that same technique. Slice through the ionosphere, after I tell you what the ionosphere is, and reconstruct it in real time. So another way that you may have seen tomography is that if you have to take an MRI, something like that, they slide you into this scary machine that's making some funny noise. And the funny noise are electromagnetic radiation that's being sent through your body, and this electromagnetic radiation is collected, and these returns can be turned into these slides that I've been talking about. So what the technician will do in the background is to take these returns, put these slides back together, look at what's inside the head, and based on the distribution inside the head, they can tell various diagnostic, they can do various diagnostic things with it. So we're hoping to use the same kind of techniques, taking slides through the atmosphere to do reconstruction the same way. So let me give you some history. So what is the atmosphere? What is that stuff that we've been talking about here? So it started out by some experiment from an Italian scientist called Marconi. And what he theorized is that there is somewhere in the atmosphere, which is a space above the Earth's surface, starting from 90 kilometers to about 1,000 kilometers. He's saying this region of the Earth's atmosphere, there's hanging charge, free charge in there. And he says, to prove that to you, what I'm going to do is I'm going to say at one end of the Earth, sending a signal across the Atlantic to the other end, and if there is no charge pending, this signal should fly through without any problem. But if there is some charge pending in there, there should be some interaction between the signal that's flying and the charge, and maybe this charge, this signal will bounce somewhere else. So that was his theory. So what he started with a daring experiment of using a kite. They actually took a kite, put the small antenna, 152.4 meter antenna, radiating at this frequency, and they sent this. You can see them here, actual picture of them taking this kite, hanging this antenna, and then flying the kite with the antenna and radiating out. And what they were hoping to see is this behavior. So they were right here somewhere, and they're saying, well, if there's no charge up here, this thing should just fly out. Right? If there is some charge, it should bounce back somewhere here, somewhere in an island here called Newfoundland, somewhere in Canada. And that's what happened. They were able to receive these signals down here. So that was the first confirmation there's something up there where that these signals are bouncing off of. Right? There's another thing in this picture, and that is not a receiving antenna. these are cannons, right? And because this island has a rich history of wars between the French and the British that were trying to fight for this island. There's a whole number of them here. But anyway, Marconi was able to verify his theory that if you send a signal from across the Atlantic and it will bounce, so there's something up there. And then that started a whole series of investigation as to what is this medium up there. So here's a little bit of his history with that. So Marconi did that in 1901, tried transmission of radio signals that hinted at the existence of some sort of medium up there. Then in 1925, there were a number of other experimental observations that confirmed this finding. In 1930, Chapman was the first person that came up with a way of modeling how the electrons are distributed along this column. And 1958, Gordon was able to study the properties of the atmosphere in details, which I'm going to talk to you a little bit more in details later. 1962, he was able to verify his studies by independent confirmation from radars. In other words, he was able to make the radar behave the same way as if you were sending signal from the point. By 1988, a gentleman by Jeff Austin out of the University of Texas was the first person to show that you can do reconstruction of the atmosphere using tomography. And that started the whole train of thought about what I'm doing today. Okay, wave propagation. So if you take a vacuum in free space, that is like you assume there's nothing up there, it's just free space, then you send a wave supposed to travel at the speed of light. You can look at the basic equation of the simplest form, Maxwell's equations for that, for free space propagation, and you come up with, by coupling these two equations, you come up with the wave equation, And then if you restrict it further, just say that electric field is propagating in just one direction, and then you can get rid of some of these differentials and come up with a very easy solution to the electric field, assuming that you say that the field is sinusoidal, you come up with something like this. It's propagating sinusoidally outward in some direction. So in this here, time is in second, omega is 2 pi f, is radian frequency related to frequency in hertz, E is electric field, H is the magnetic field, and this is an instance of what they would look like in terms of propagation. So one of them, for that particular case, is propagating in kind of the Z direction, the other one is the S direction, and the third direction will become the direction of propagation. So this is the simplest visualization of a wave propagating, say, in free space. Now, free space means there's nothing out there. Now here comes the atmosphere. Where does that come from? Well, we have the sun. The sun sends ultraviolet rays on the Earth, and the atmosphere of Earth is composed of a bunch of atoms and molecules of that sort: nitrogen oxide, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen. And these ultraviolet rays have enough energy, they can strip electrons off the valence band of these molecules, and they can start creating free charges. So that process continues, amplifies around 12 o'clock noon, and goes down around 6 o'clock. And this charge accumulates between 50,000 kilometers, and this is what we call the atmosphere. It's a section of charge above the Earth's surface, sitting in an annular region starting from 50 to 1,000, and that's what we've been calling atmosphere. This is the medium upon which, when we have interaction of signals, the signals can bounce off of this. Specifically, these are the type of behaviors we expect, and we've gone and looked at various experiments of how the atmosphere behaves. They see it's not just what Marconi saw, that you have this type of behavior. In this case, here the atmosphere is sitting up here, this is the surface of Earth, and this signal is bouncing off the atmosphere and you can receive it here. So that's the behavior you saw. But there's other behaviors we can see also. You can see this behavior, where the signal goes right through the atmosphere. It's bent maybe, but it goes right through. There's this behavior, where the signal is completely absorbed by the atmosphere, it's gone, lost. And there's this behavior, where the signal can be scattered by the atmosphere, goes all over the place. So trying to understand all these behaviors, we see that there is something called the critical frequency. The critical frequency is a frequency that is established by this number of electrons sitting up there. And by the time you do some simple computation, this critical frequency is directly proportional to the number of electrons sitting. So it's this thing here, nice square root of Ne. Doesn't look real, right? But it is. It's directly proportional to the number of electrons up there. So depending on the number of electrons up here, if the critical frequency that you use in your signal is higher than this, the signal goes right through. If it's lower, then the signal will behave like this. And then there's some two other behaviors that I'm not going to get into: absorption and scattering, is when the atmosphere is not behaving as a plasma, and it's a lot of other things here that I'm not going to get into. But that's the basic idea. So with that, a lot of theories were developed to see what kind of frequency can be used to go through the atmosphere, and that's not going to go through. So this line here, which sits at VHF, it's typically anything over that line will go through, anything below that line will bounce. So you can do a lot of radio communication along HF, high frequency, medium frequency, low frequency, very low frequency, very easily using the atmosphere. Actually, that's what's done. That's what we do. Okay, so how do we sense it? How do we sense the atmosphere? So one of the things we do for that particular behavior here, that behavior where a signal can go through, all that's happening here is It's probably going to be a difference in phase in the signal by the time it gets back down that one. So what people have been doing is they've been looking at the phase difference between the signal that was sent and the signal that's received, and they were able to relate that to what he's been calling the TEC, which is the total electron content along the line of path of the signal. So you send a signal, travels up, comes back down. What you know the phase at which you sent it, you know the phase at which you received it, so you can relate these two phases, the change in two phases, with the number of electrons that this star had to go through. Very interesting discovery. There's some error terms there. There's an error in the satellite position, an error in the receiver position, and some additional errors that we don't know anything about. And we know these fairly well most of the time, but we still have to account for that additional error, which has to be with noise in general. By the time this is all done, what we end up doing is relating the total electron content, the number of electrons that you find along the line of sight, to, you know, the line integral to the electron density. So if you take an integral along that line that you send the signal through, what that integral gives you is TC. We're going to talk a lot about TEC. Now, I talked to you about before about the model that was done by Chapman. After many years, Chapman was able to come up with a model of the electron density. You can see it's a fairly nonlinear thing, function of second of chi and exponential. So it's not a friendly model. But what it gives you is what is the variation, typical variation of the electron density with respect to height. So as you go up, how does it vary? And what you're going to see is it has a magnitude and a height. Those two things, the strength of it and the height where the maximum number of electrons is found, is really what distinguishes the model from 1.29. Okay. Actually, that was my thesis. I mean, you'd be able to find this point in near real time. If you were to start with any old prediction, how do you find that exact height and that exact magnitude for a particular time? That was the object of my thesis. And this is kind of a glossary of what these terms mean. Again, this is, you don't have to understand all that. Just know phase difference gives you TC. There's a bunch of error terms that we have to deal with when we're dealing with this problem. So we have to add a noise term here. Okay. So how do we model it? So is this thing, this annular region sitting up in space? We want to know the number of electrons in each one of these little areas here that we call voxels. So let's say we have a satellite that's traveling overhead, and we have some receivers on the ground. So we end up having lines of communication between the satellite and the receiver, and this distance here where we're going through the electron density is what we are measuring, the number of electrons along these lines. And that's what we're calling the TC. So what we end up saying is that we can relate the TC to line integrals, we said that before, and we can make a model of the density as kind of a linear combination of these voxels here, right? And we're going to take the voxel to be trivial. In other words, we're going to say it's either the voxel is there or it's not. So it's either it's 1 or 0. So I'm going to have a value when I go along this line. I'm going to have a value, this voxel, this voxel, this voxel, but obviously nothing there, right? But what that is saying at the same time is that I'm assuming that within the voxel, electron density is constant, right? Because I'm not making any exponential or any kind of model here. So I'm assuming within that voxel, that value inside of that is constant all the time. That's not the case. What we're assuming. So here's a voxel, for example, that's represented in spherical coordinate system. So we are assuming that within this entire voxel here, the value that is right in the middle of it, in the center of the voxel, is the value that's throughout this voxel. That's not typically the case, but we made that assumption. So that's another error term that we have to account for. Okay. So you can imagine that if we take these, go back to these planes here, we can look at these as planes. This is one, this is another, this is another. And we can cut these planes through just like we're doing for the head of that guy that wasn't too happy, right? And we can reconstruct these planes and put them back together and reconstruct the atmosphere, same problem, okay? And that's exactly what we do. That's how we tomography is brought into there. Here's one of these planes, and we can take several of these, and by the time we reconstruct them to a volume, we end up with things like this, where you can clearly see there's a high value here, not so high there. So your peak will be at this height, and it will be of that intensity. Remember, we say it's 2 parameters, a magnitude and a height, that's where we have it. And you can do the stuff also with GPS, which we're using. So about 9 to 10 GPS are visible at any which time. Anything, all we need is about 4 of them to come up with this phase difference that we're talking about. So we can use the same kind of thing. So interestingly enough, for some of the work we're doing, for Haiti, for example, which I'm going to show you some result, we're doing satellite going overhead. I think Michael is working on that. And for Japan, we're doing GPS, and Joseph is working on that. I'm going to show you what the results are at the end of this talk. Okay, so let's talk a little bit of algebra, just before I start talking about system complexity, difficult, and all that. So let's look at some simple algebra. Let's say we have this system of equations. 2 equations, 2 unknowns. I can solve this problem very, very quickly using algebra, right? Take the second equation, multiply by 2, add it to the first, and I can solve for d1, d2. Piece of cake, right? Well, what about if I only have 1 equation? Can I solve this? How many people take linear algebra here? Should have the answer. Can I solve this if I was just the first equation? How many solutions do I have? Anybody? Michael? So if we have 1 equation, right? We have 1 equation and 2 unknowns, not enough equations, infinite amount of solution. So I need something else here to solve. And most of the problem we're solving, that's the case. We have these ill-conditioned matrices. And so in this case, what I'll have is a line, and I'll show you some of that in a minute. Infinite amount of pair d1, d2 that will all give me a good solution. So here's this in form of matrices. So in this first case here, where I solve that, I will be able to take the inverse of this matrix. It will be defined, and there will be just 1 solution. In this case, I will not be able to take the inverse of that matrix. There will be infinite amount of solutions. So, tomography is the reconstruction of an image to extract these D here, these D pairs out of C, which is, I'm going to call it D, I'm going to say that this is density for me, electron density, and C is TC for me. So when I pose a problem like this, what I'm looking to do is to extract D from C. So I get these TCs, I want to infer the electron density from it, and I have to be able to invert this matrix. That's why they call these problems inverse problems, because the only way I'm going to be able to do that is that I must be able to invert the matrix. If I cannot, then I have to come up with some other interesting way of solving this problem. So there's a lot of solutions that have been proposed. I'll quickly go over them and show you why I don't use them, right? So here's this basic system of equation, right? Is my TEC is related to my density through a matrix. There's some noise term here that I talked about before. I can write the solution like this ugly looking set of matrices here in a method for single value decomposition. This matrix are projection matrix that are written like this as a function of this A here. So clearly I must be able to take the inverse of this matrix and stuff, and that's not very easy to do. Okay? So, and I'm going to leave it at that. So taking the inverse of this matrix is not easy to do, and I'm going to give you an example of that in a minute. So here's a simple example. I take an atmosphere with just two cells. I try to formulate a problem, so I have one measurement, two unknown, and then if I formulate this problem, this is my solution. It's a line, like I said before. Any point C is a solution. So I can play a game with this stuff. I'll show you a number of different solution groups. Number of different solutions here. I can play a game to pick a point here. I can say I want the point that's closest to zero. I can say I want a point that is the closest to my measurements. I can say I want the singular value decomposition point, which I showed you all the ugly matrices before. So you see the difference between which point I'm picking here depends on what I'm assuming, right? Because I have to make an assumption. So when we have a real problem in tomography, so here's a real problem. We have about 131,000 voxels here, these little points. And we have an A matrix that is of that size, 2400 by 131,000. So clearly it's an undetermined system. You have more unknown than the equations. So it's similar to the thing I showed you before. And you cannot just take the inverse of this matrix. It may not exist. So all the traditional methods typically don't work here. If you were to find a way to solve this by using singular value decomposition, for example, you end up with order of operation being, this is the number of operation you have to do to invert this matrix using some sort of method that I showed before. So with your fastest CPU, you need about 209 hours to solve this problem. So clearly you don't want to do that, right? You don't want to do that. So we use a totally different set of techniques called iterative methods in order to solve this problem, which I'm not going to get into here. But I just wanted to give you an appreciation for the complexity of the problem. Okay, earthquakes. How do we use that in earthquakes? So basically with earthquakes, we see that what's going on is the theory has been that the earth is made of plates. Those plates shift. They can shift in many directions. Here they're shifting along each other, like this. Here they're shifting away from each other. Here they're shifting toward each other. And what's happening is these movements take place all the time, but very slowly, millimeters kind of thing. Now when an earthquake is taking place, all of a sudden this movement becomes very fast, and that's why you end up with earthquakes. Right? So the idea is, how can we come up with a technique of predicting this kind of fast changing of plates sometime before the earthquake occurs? Currently, the way we're measuring it is we put GPS along faults where we know there's going to be this motion, and we're measuring how far the GPS are moving from each other. So we don't get to see the fast motion until the earthquake is actually there. Okay? And that's the problem. Can we get it 2 days before? Is there any other technique that we can use to get it a couple of days, a couple of months before? You have a question? So about a year and a half ago, a couple of people from NASA started with a set of theories that's just doing that. What they're saying is, you have some disturbance that is way inside the Earth core that are producing crystal deformation. So when you start having, when an earthquake is going to occur, there's a certain amount of forces way inside the Earth core that end up producing crystal deformation. These crystal deformations, what they end up doing is creating free positive charge on the Earth's surface. So, and they call them P holes. So this free positive hole, as they become available, they become primary suspect for electron to try to jump into these p-holes. And so after they jump into these p-holes, so they appear, they can travel up in the Earth's atmosphere and reach the ionosphere, and then they can change the concentration of electron in the Earth's atmosphere. So what you have is a series of forces inside the Earth's core. They produce disturbance that create P holes, positive holes. These positive holes attract electrons. The these electrons are created, and then they eventually travel up the Earth to the region of the atmosphere, and then they are the one that create the disturbance we see. And the theory is that you can see these disturbances sometimes months before the event. So they came up with a number of ways of verifying this. First of all, they come up with a theory of showing you this thing within crystals, how they can put defects inside a crystal, create p-holes, show that electron jump in and all that. And then the next thing they were able to show is actually an experiment where they took a slab of granite, they crushed it, and they were able to show as they crushed it, electrons started showing up. And I'm going to show you my own simulation of that, to show you that. So here's a slab of granite. Here's the hydraulic press on each side of it, 200 kilometers of granite block. And now if I start applying the press into it, all of a sudden the P holes start showing up. They accelerate again away from each other to the Earth's surface. And then all of a sudden electrons are attracted. This electron travel with the electric field. And then eventually they end up in atmospheric height. And they add up or subtract to the atmosphere that's there already to create the disturbance that you see. That's the theory. Okay. Now we're going to try to look at whether or not this is verifiable. So this is the first example. The earthquake took place in Haiti along here. This is Haiti sitting down here. So that's a fault right here. And the earthquake was around here. You can clearly see after the earthquake, they put a number of satellites. It wasn't there before. Number of GPS satellites along these faults now. I might be able to use at some point. But fortunately, what was happening here is, so this is statistics about the earthquake, everybody knows about that. There was a French satellite that was in orbit, taking measurement around fault around that time. And after the earthquake occurred, they were able to go back and look at some of these measurements. One of these instruments, this thing here, that's sticking a poor bound, is what they call instrument Sondelandmeer, which is an instrument that's just measuring the number of electrons at this point. And they were able to take a lot of measurements of the atmosphere over here in several other places. And Michael and I have been looking at this. So first, I did some work on that beforehand. So here's kind of an atmosphere over Haiti. You can kind of see this here. This is kind of a model of what the atmosphere is going to be over Haiti. So I took that, used tomography to get the inverse. And so here is actually the data that's coming from the satellite. So you can clearly see here, the satellite is flying up here. And you see all these jiggle here is basically disturbance in the atmosphere. And here is our model as compared to it. So here's the atmosphere here. Here's, I'm saying, this is the model. So clearly you can see the difference between the model and the atmosphere itself is that jiggle here. Right? So what you expect to see is, if you were to take a background atmosphere, it would be smooth, okay, and probably lower than this. And then right around that same point, you will see this jiggle, and you will have to be able to assess this jiggle in time, predict it, and use it to say that this is characteristic of the earthquake. And that's where the challenge is, right? So I think Michael took that a bit further. So here's some of the pictures I was showing probably a year ago. Well, over Haiti on November 30th, 2009, we had these little bumps. I think the top one was December 2009. This is November 2009, and that cross here is Haiti. So here's these bumps showing up of Haiti. So we written a paper and submitted that paper to a journal, and they say, well, you show me this stuff every month. What we want to see is a collection of these over 6 months, and we want to see the same behavior. Wow, this is what Michael started doing. This is over, what's that, Michael? 3 months? 2 months, right? Is that 2 months? So in 2 months, he showed us that, first of all, you have this huge enhancement And you have this depletion here, the love one and hate is wide here. Seem to be the same behavior, but Michael's gonna show you way more of that. So you wanna show up for his talk for a lot of these kinds of pictures. Okay, the next thing we looked at is Japan earthquake. So the earthquake took place here, underwater. That's why we had all this tsunami stuff. And so here is wanted to show you the coverage of Japan. This is how many GPS receivers are over Japan. See, the entire place is covered with that stuff. If you look at Japan, look at this. So this is a goal of mine for studying this problem, right? That's why we're looking at it. So right now, Joe is working on that. I've been messing with his data. He's created a huge data structure. It's about 1,225 sites, and each one of them has 45 areas of taking data, if I can say that, for a 24-hour period. It's a lot of data that you have to make sense of. So just for this presentation, I looked at eight sites. So they're in the northern part of Japan. And I want to show you some pictures out of that. So here's the TEC over 24 hours period for these sites. So you can see these smooth behaviors, and all of a sudden you have these drops. So here is the way I would have expected TEC to behave, right? But all of a sudden TEC goes down to -150, right? And you see the behavior throughout, right? This enhancement and drops. And we're going to show you what that looks like when I take an average of this. This is what it looks like. So here's my behavior that I expect, smooth behavior. Like Professor Henke was showing, I would expect the other side to be exactly the same, smoothly going up. But look at that, jumping all over the place, everywhere. And so we have to come up with a way of taking this and transforming it into prediction. Okay? Transforming that into prediction. That's a challenge, but that's what we need to do. So those are TEC fluctuations. This was, how long before the earthquake was that? You know? Okay, so that at least the month of the earthquake over Japan, so probably a few days. So you can see these visible fluctuations that we have to characterize. So here's another interesting picture. So this is the eight sites. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And what I'm displaying on the y-axis here is time. And what's in the picture is the intensity of the TEC. And that's the scale. So reddish is high intensity, bluish is low intensity. And from our point of view, this is a huge enhancement and this is a depletion. And in at least six of these sites, at the same time frame, you see exactly the same behavior, right? Same time frame, about 20 UT, or the onset of 20 UT, which we have to correlate with local time in Japan, so I'm thinking it's probably 3:45 or so. That's what you see. So it's the same fluctuation we've been seeing in the previous panel, that you see jump, and all of a sudden, it's high, it's low, it's high, it's low, etc. So we have to come up with a way of taking this sort of information and relating it to prediction. Okay. And this was, then we have to get the dates also. I think it's, not sure if it's 3 days or whatever. So Joe will tell you more about that in about a month or so. So the key takeaway here, the fluctuation of visible from six sites around the same place. So, so we show that tomography has pretty good potential for doing seismic prediction. I showed you just one quick example. Preliminary work by students on both Haiti and Japan seem to produce promising results. We have to firm it up a bit to come up with predictive parameters, but that could be a few more students maybe, I don't know. And definitely more investigation is required, right, to make that turn that into a predictive technique. So where do we go from here? We definitely want to stay in touch with Professor Hagi, with data, giving us all this sad information, giving us code. Even though we were unfortunate, but still, that was a lot of help. And we have ongoing collaboration with these entities, places, Glasgow and Boston, MIT STAC, University of Purdue, and GPL Laboratory that we want to continue to have student involvement in this type of undergraduate research, in applied geography, in other areas, not just seismic prediction, and then expand the research project to other areas such as renewable energy. We're hoping Sandesh Wazi and Jean is going to be able to tell us some things in this area that we started up with, and then bring forth more areas like signal image processing, telecommunication, remote sensing, social enterprising, and in fact we're starting a remote sensing mini lab here in a month or so. So a lot of exciting things going on. Okay, I have just filled your head with a lot of stuff. Any questions? With this at the speed of light. There was no ionosphere stopping me, so. Any questions?
I'll ask one. Obviously, the Haiti site and the Japanese site, two different techniques. But a Langmuir probe, I think, only senses a local electron density, whereas the GPS. So, how do you get the height variation and so forth with the Langmuir probe?
Actually, the Langmuir probe gives you the density at a height. So it's flying. So it's usually flying about 650. So it's giving you that.
Yeah.
So one of the things we're working on right now, my brother and I, is to retrace the model of that along the same path. So we'll be able to tell you, with our best knowledge, this is the prediction we would have for this atmosphere on a daily basis. And Michael will be able to show you how that deviates from what we measure, from an earthquake-prone measurement kind of thing, earthquake-reflective of an earthquake. For GPS, it's totally different. We're measuring the direction along the line of sight, and we're reconstructing it from that. So we get one point, and we try to say we're going to go and then infer all the other points. Yeah. So it's kind of different. Yes?
So you say you can measure UCS activity an hour prior to the earthquake. You talked about trying to get this a week or a month before. Have you looked at data further back, and is the trend consistent enough so that you could see even a subtle?
Excellent question. Actually, I think some of the data Michael is working on is scary. We're looking at this stuff, we would see it 3 months before. Very accurate. So now I'm worried, right? Because it looks too good to be true. So I'm just saying, well, go 6 months before and go 6 months after. See if we don't see any bump. Because if we see a bump, now I start scratching my head trying to understand the data. But yeah, 3-4 months before, we can see this trend. So the idea is, so some of the work that's been done is you try to say, okay, what's a mean behavior? So what's the level you expect to have? And how far are you deviating from that when the earthquake is taking place? So maybe we come up with something like two sigma away, you know, from a mean behavior. Then you start saying, well, maybe there's something going on here. Those are the kind of predictive things that we're starting to think about to say something intelligent about whether or not there's a difference in ionosphere behavior. More questions? No more questions? Okay, well good. I want to thank all of you for coming. And so, tomorrow we have Dr. Flies, good thing he wasn't there, he didn't come to Dr. Flies. Dr. Flies is here. Thank you all for coming. So keep coming, right? This thing continues up. Come and encourage your colleagues when they're giving these presentations. Please. Thank you very much.